fellow handlers. This is a continuation of the previous video in the series being produced on this channel regarding the lore of the Delta Green role-playing game. If you have not seen the previous videos in this series, I would highly recommend them and will be linking a playlist above, as in this episode, we are picking up with the development of several classified Delta Green and US defense projects, along with the fallout from the Karatekia's unnatural dealings. Rewinding to late 1940, Rudolf Leidenberg, a German émergé and prominent atomic physicist, convinces the U.S. National Defense Research Committee and Department of the Navy to establish Project Rainbow for the development of stealth and defensive naval technologies. Based in Newark, New Jersey, Project Rainbow recruits some of the most famous scientists and engineers in the United States, including Albert Einstein. 1 month before the Japanese attack on Pearl Harbor, Project Rainbow holds its first conference and develops various key sub-projects. One of these teams was concentrated on a project nicknamed Mirage, which was tasked with developing electronic devices to conceal naval craft. Dr. Arthur Turner is made chief of Project Mirage, which is treated as low priority and given little funding by the Navy due to their lack of confidence. Within roughly 2 years, Dr. Arthur Turner of Subproject Mirage devises a new mechanism to visually camouflage a naval vessel by forming an electromagnetic shell around the ship to ionize the surrounding air and create a blurry distortion. In conjunction with Albert Einstein at Project 5, Turner made a device, codenamed Mirage 2. 2 weeks later, after dozens of failed Mirage 2 experiments pursuing electromagnetic invisibility, Dr. Turner developed the idea of fluxing two electromagnetic fields within precise ranges to cause a sympathetic electromagnetic flux. Turner and his team designed a half dozen prototypes over the next 3 months, with none of them working for more than a minute before draining its batteries. Parallel to the developments of Project Rainbow, in February of 1942, Lieutenant Commander Martin Cook, commanding officer of B-4, briefs William J. Donovan on some of B-4's experiences. Cook recommends B-4 be merged with the OSS as an unconventional warfare unit, whose official purpose is to investigate the occult and unnatural for exploitation in psychological operations against the Axis. The group is called Delta Green. During this time, a doctor in Far Eastern Studies at Harvard University named Joseph Camp left his career of Ivy League research to work for P4. He is sent to Camp X, the OSS training facility in Canada, for agent development. Joseph Camp is reassigned by Delta Green to serve with Attachment 101 in Burma after his training at Camp X. Dr. Camp never receives a Delta Green clearance before he is reassigned. However, he would eventually become a future officer in the OSS and an instrumental member of Delta Green. In early 1942, Pisces observed some brand new Delta Green agents rummaging around old Admiralty records, leading to the first official meeting between the two agencies. After several more weeks of guarded meetings, both agencies reveal their mutual interest in unnatural affairs. Under the leadership of newly promoted Commander Martin Cook, Delta Green set about defeating the Karatekia under the guise of researching and conducting Allied psychological warfare operations. Many operations involved recovering or destroying books and artifacts that the Karatekia was interested in. Shortly before the meeting with Commander Cook, and supported by the long-range desert group, LRDG, Pisces discovers a ruined city in the Libyan desert, but is prevented from a full excavation due to the approach of the Nazis' Africa Corps. The LRDG destroys the entrance to a vast underground chamber of the city shortly before a Karatekia unit arrives on site. But that was not all the Karatekia worked to accomplish. By summer of 1942, the .103 team of Operation Ice Palace had decoded enough of the Lost City's pictograms to learn the history of the Thulian race, including their wars with conical time travelers centered in Australia, crustacean-like entities who mined the Earth's highest ranges, and semi-aquatic octopoid creatures whose home was a now-submerged continent in the Pacific. 2 months later, Karateka agents arrive in Antwerp, Belgium, after several books on the Ananurbi's Bulletin of Useful Texts were reportedly found in the offices of a, quote-unquote, liquidated Jewish merchant. In the offices, the group finds a crate marked German, England, with 1913 postmarks and, inside the crate, a stuffed, white-furred, ape-like creature. A plaque identifies the creature as a species called Shimbote in the Imbanglu dialect, discovered in Thiel, Belgian Congo, in 1913. Investigation into the creature is designated Project Parsifal. The Karateka instructs Abwehr agents inside Britain to learn more about the history of Sir Arthur German and his ancestral estate, the German House. Significant developments would occur in November of 1942, as under the guise of an Einsatzkommando action against partisans, the commander of Project Blackwater sends an SS detachment to capture the entire town of Maurice, massacring the adult male population and marching the women and children to Cap de la Hague, where they are placed in separate holding areas. Project Blackwater trades 14 of the Maurice women to the Deep Ones in exchange for 35 bars of British gold and detailed intelligence on the Cornwall and Dover coasts. The Karateka is informed by the Deep Ones that, by the next new moon, their leader, Dagon, will arrive to seal their alliance. At Cap de la Hague, the Deep One named Claude informs the Karateka of the conditions required for Dagon's arrival, including the ritual use of numerous black stones. A forced labor crew is brought to Cap de la Hague to raise the stones and become the sacrifices for Dagon. However, the Allies would be busy too, as Pisces agents learn the location of the Blackwater facility at Cap de la Hague and pass it on to Delta Green. It was uncovered that these supposed experiments that were performed, which required considerable requisitions of test subjects from Auschwitz and Treblinka. What happened to these test subjects was a mystery even to the SS officers intimately involved with the final solution, although it surprised no one at Delta Green when they uncovered the Nazis were sacrificing them to curry favors with the same creatures the Navy had faced in Innsmouth 15 years before. Delta Green agents are transported to Cap de la Hague, France, by the end of the month, where they link up with French partisans and prepare to raid the Blackwater facility. Called Operation Lifeguard, this is Delta Green's first European operation. Then, on December 8, 1942, just as Project Blackwater conducts a ritual to welcome Dagon to Cap de la Hague, a force of Delta Green operatives and local French partisans under Operation Lifeguard raid the facility. The Deep Ones attack both the Allied raiders and the German hosts, and all further contact between the Karateka and the Deep One colony is severed, ending Project Blackwater. From the Karateka files, Delta Green learns of the Donnerschlag, some type of sonic cannon, a Karateka weapon constructed by Dr. William Eisenbein and his researchers at a facility in the French coastal town of Fécamp. Pisces had provided intel for the raid as a test, one which Delta Green passed, and both groups cooperated enthusiastically for a short time. By the end of 1942, William J. Donovan, commander of the OSS, and David Cornwall, commander of Pisces, meet at Kilmar Manor to work out an intelligence-sharing program between Pisces and Delta Green. Donovan is introduced to the capabilities of Pisces, a natural talent, for the first time, and a four-man team is composed of both Pisces and Delta Green agents to infiltrate the Karoltekia facility in Fekam. Their mission is to gather information on the Donnerschlag weapon before the installation is destroyed by RAF bombardment. However, the entire team is lost save for US Army Major Michael Stillman, who discovers that the structure was wiped out by invisible things following the tests of the Donnerschlag. Luckily, Stillman was able to escape with blueprints for the unnatural device. There were also signs of similar unnatural activities in the Pacific Theater. Here, Delta Green went head-to-head with a semi-official Japanese organization called the Genosha, or Black Ocean Society. Part political party, part secret society, and part unofficial black ops and espionage arm of the Japanese military, the Black Ocean Society had been infiltrating secret groups, criminal organizations, and occult brotherhoods across Asia since 1881. At some point, members of the Black Ocean had become aware of the efficacy of strange rituals. By the mid-1930s, they were trying to find unnatural means to aid Japan's war effort. Having no official standing, the members of the Black Ocean Society exercised power through their official positions in the Imperial Japanese Army, government ministries, and the Kempeitai, the Japanese secret police. Throughout mainland China, Southeast Asia, Australia, and, in direct contravention of the wishes of General MacArthur, throughout Melanesia, Micronesia, and Polynesia, Delta Green teams intercepted and neutralized Black Ocean Society projects to develop and deploy weapons garnered from unnatural sources. And, on New Year's Day of 1943, Pisces uncovers a plot by the Genosha to incite a revolt against British rule in eastern India by reviving the Thuggee cult. And, throughout the war and after, Pisces would track down and suppress any resurgences of the cult. By February of 1942, Delta Green created two separate teams. The first was assigned to the Belgian Congo to locate the lost city of Thule before the Karoltekia's Project Parsifal could find it and destroy the city. A second team was sent to the Gibson Desert in Australia to locate the source of a pre-human library said to exist there. To assist the investigation, Delta Green recruits Wingate Peasley to the second team to investigate his father, Nathaniel Peasley, and the connection to whatever the Karoltekia is after with Project Parsifal. Accompanied by Project Lifeguard veteran Thomas Arnold, Wingate goes to Australia to discover what his father found in the Western Desert during the Miskatonic Expedition in 1935. However, the situation reaches a boiling point when William J. Donovan learns that Pisces had sent agents to assassinate the Delta Green team in Australia and seize the pre-human books and artifacts that supposedly could allow humans to know and control the future. Ties between Delta Green and Pisces have since been severed. Independent of Pisces, Delta Green would continue operations against Karoltekia and Black Ocean Society operatives across Europe and Asia and into neutral nations like Ireland, Turkey, and Spain. Delta Green also operated freely in South America, even though it was forbidden. This exception to the FBI's jurisdiction was created once Commander Martin Cook informed J. Edgar Hoover that Delta Green was working on an Innsmouth problem. Nothing more was said on the matter. Returning to Project Rainbow, Timothy Michelson, a Project Mirage researcher, witnesses Franklin Rathke to stage a public demonstration of a device named the Tillinghast Resonator in a bid to entice investors while on Christmas vacation in 1942. The next day, Michelson writes a letter to Dr. Arthur Turner of Project Mirage detailing Franklin Rathke's demonstration of the Tillinghast Resonator. Intrigued by how the resonator can create such a significant field effect with little power, Michelson's letter convinces Turner that the resonator might solve the unsustainable power requirements of the Mirage device. 3 months later, Dr. Arthur Turner meets with Franklin Rathke for the first and last time at the Boston Federal Building. After witnessing a miniature version of the Tillinghast resonator, Turner pays $4,000 to Rathke in exchange for the device and plans for its construction. By March of 1943, at the Project Mirage Laboratory and the Newark Naval Shipyards, Dr. Arthur Turner modifies the Tillinghast Resonator into a device large enough to obscure a destroyer escort-sized vessel using air ionization. While Turner's modifications are sufficient to protect those outside the resonator field from the radiation, anyone within the field would still be in danger. Turner performs the test on models that convince the Navy to fully fund and expand Project Mirage. Neither the Navy nor Turner recognizes the hazards that will soon become apparent in the Tillinghast resonator. Over the later months of 1943, Dr. Arthur Turner and his greatly expanded Project Mirage team began construction on a fully sized prototype of the Tillinghast resonator. The National Defense Research Council secures the USS Eldridge to test the Mirage 3 device. A false report claiming that the Eldridge spends the next 3 months at sea on a shakedown cruise is filed, while, for the next 6 weeks, the ship is fitted by the Project Mirage team with the device in the Newark Naval Facility. Dr. Arthur Turner briefs the crew of the USS Eldridge on their role in the Mirage 3 testing and introduces Dr. Townsend Brown, one of Turner's assistants who will join the USS Eldridge during its mission. Only Brown and Commander Joseph M. Connolly, captain of the Eldridge, know the true nature of the Mirage 3 experiment. On October 28th of 1943, the Mirage 3 device was activated aboard the USS Eldridge in the Pocomoke Sound of Chesapeake Bay, immediately causing the Eldridge to become radar invisible and disappear entirely from the visible spectrum. It was lost by its escort ships when the device was activated. In effect, for 22 minutes, the USS Eldridge ceased to exist. When the Eldridge was located, adrift and seemingly dead in the water, the true horrors of the Tillinghast resonator were discovered. Less than half of the crew survived their journey elsewhere. Some of the dead were embedded in bulkheads, their bodies fused with the steel at an atomic level. 32 of the 55 crew members are dead or missing when the ship is located. The survivors report seeing otherworldly creatures from beyond and strange figures dressed in large suits like Army Air Force fire crews. Two of these mysterious figures are found dead on board, their bodies carrying advanced technology. The incident has lived on in conspiracy folklore, commonly known as the Philadelphia Experiment. It has fostered movies and books which hint at the true horrors endured by the crew of the ill-fated Eldridge. At the end of World War II, the Eldridge event was seen as an embarrassing secret aside from war research. The government would become aware of the threat the Tillinghast resonator represented later. By the next day, the 23 survivors of the USS Eldridge are admitted to the Bethesda Naval Hospital for psychiatric treatment. Three crewmen later die in custody, one commits suicide, and only 15 are ever released. Among those 15, only Dr. Townsend Brown and Commander Joseph Connolly resume everyday lives. Over the next month, the Office of Naval Intelligence carries out Project Puzzle, the investigation and cover-up of the Mirage 3 experiment. The USS Eldridge is secured in an enclosed dock at the Norfolk Naval Yard, where it remains until 1982. The two unidentified bodies are sent to Bethesda Naval Hospital for study. On New Year's Eve of 1943, Dr. Townsend Brown begins researching gravitators to create aerial vehicles with anti-gravity propulsion in his spare time, and joins the Lockheed Vega Aircraft Corporation in California. While the war's landscape was changing and the Nazi defeat looked ever more imminent, the Caltechia's Point 103 researchers conducted the first test of a strange sphere seemingly designed by the pre-human civilization, a weapon estimated to have the power to destroy a city, in early 1943. The test is partially successful. Karl Ohlendorf receives orders from Berlin to keep the artifacts excavated at Point 103 in Antarctica rather than ship them back to Germany. A group from the rocket facility at Peenemünde is sent to Point 103 to confine the A4 delivery system with the strange sphere found a week before, creating a weapon that the Point 103 team names the N03 rocket. The researchers complete the rocket within 10 months, finally achieving success on the 12th of December of 1943, but its range is too short to reach any major Allied city from Antarctica. The suggestion was made to deal with Argentinian Vice President Juan Perón to launch from Buenos Aires, but it was rejected by Karl Ohlendorf. He decides to abandon the rocket and concentrate on further excavation. Paired with Point 103, the Karatekia discovered a translation of the Necronomicon in ancient Gothic. Through the arcane knowledge provided by the tome, Karatekia researchers perfect a method for reviving the dead. Truckloads of resuscitated casualties are driven to the Eastern Front. Shortly after, Karatekia researcher Olaf Bitterich disenters the corpse of Alexei Lado, an associate of Friedrich Wilhelm von Jungst. Within Lado's casket, Bitterich finds the papers from von Jungst's unfinished and allegedly burnt manuscript of the Unaussprechlichen Kulten. Bitterich uses these papers to call upon the spirit of something that claims to be Frederick the Great. This success leads Bitterich to become a favorite of Himmler and Hitler. He calls upon German heroes such as Otto von Bismarck, Friedrich Nietzsche, and Hermann the Cherusker to advise the Führer and his Reichsführer. At the beginning of 1945, resuscitated casualties, Poiviatsa, to the Soviets, were first encountered by GRU SV-8 when the Karatekia released them in and around the city of Lodz to hinder the movement of the First Belarusian Front. By the end of January of 1945, 7 Karatekia researchers and 73 SS support personnel at Naudobaum Castle were obliterated, along with much of the mountain upon which it sits, during an abortive and poorly understood attempt to summon the elder god Azathoth. 5 days before the German surrender, Reinhard Galt, while on assignment for the Karatekia in Central Africa, attempts to negotiate the secret of the Ageless Banquet from the immortal cannibals of the Anzika tribe. However, upon receiving word that Hitler is dead, Galt forces his men to disarm and sacrifices them to the Ansikas to be adopted by the tribe. By the end of the week, Germany surrenders unconditionally. Of the 164 original members of the Karatekia, 37 remain. These few survivors escaped through the rat lines established by clandestine organizations like Odessa. In their research of the German naval archives, Dr. Green uncovers the logbook of Karl Heinrich, commander of the submarine U-29, which went missing under mysterious circumstances during the First World War. Based on Heinrich's descriptions of an undersea city and its strange temple, Dr. Green surmises that the Deep Ones were involved in the submarine's disappearance. Interestingly, by this time, most of the 100 copies of a purportedly cursed King in Yellow-themed tarot deck had disappeared, either in the chaos of World War II or hidden in collections by owners ignorant of their occult significance. Despite the Nazi surrender 1 month before, the Point 103 team unearths an unimaginable weapon used by the pre-human Antarctic civilization to reshape the face of the Earth. They name it the Tectonic Agitator. Karl Ohlendorf begins preparing the weapon for use. This overlaps with the launch of Operation Summer Breeze, as Dr. Green seizes and destroys Karatekia files and personnel in Vienna before they can be acquired by Smirsch. A shooting war erupts in the Vienna underworld between Dr. Green and Smirsch. GRU SV-8 takes advantage of the conflict to covertly acquire Karatekia archives and assassinate Smirsch personnel. Smirsch captures only a man calling himself Erwin Pies, an assistant on the Resuscitated Casualties Project. Following Germany's surrender, the U.S. and Soviet intelligence services rush to seize German nuclear physicists, V-2, and jet aircraft engineers, along with former intelligence officers. The Americans had Operation Paperclip, while the Soviets had Operation Osovayaki. But where the OSS and NKVD were trying to preserve knowledge, Delta Green had a different plan. Operation Summer Breeze put a team of Delta Green agents into Soviet-occupied Germany to steal or destroy Karatekia files and personnel before they were found by Stalin's secret police. Most Karatekia researchers could not be located, while those the Delta Green team judged unfit for extraction were subsequently denied to the enemy. Oddly, at least two different sets of Soviet units operated in occupied Germany, with half trying to extract former Karatekia members and the other half trying to execute them. This schizophrenic Soviet policy prompted heated debate in Delta Green regarding the Soviet intentions towards the unnatural. Through Summer Breeze, hundreds of kilograms of Reichsfuhrer's Himmler's secret files were brought to the West, while the rest were burned in place. The files were a chronicle of a prolonged disaster. The Karatekia's researchers had discovered extraordinary powers, but no means to harness them. With a few exceptions, the Karatekia's programs caused as many casualties to the Axis as to the Allies. In these files, Delta Green discovered Action Götterdämmerung, Hitler's final solution. While the nation of Germany was spent, the Karatekia fought to recreate the accident that had destroyed Narubam Castle in Bavaria. Delta Green had recently found where Narubam Castle used to be. The mountain it had sat on had been scoured away. The nearby lake showed extremely high alkaline levels, and every pine tree on the mountain had fallen away from the site. There were two apparent comparisons to be made from the devastation. The first was the 1908 Sunga blast in Siberia, which had flattened 250 square kilometers of the forest. The second was the US Army's recent test of the atomic bomb. Recovered documents indicated that the accident was some sort of interdimensional rip in space and was created through unnatural science. Something incomprehensible began to pour into our world, flattening the castle and surrounding forests and poisoning the lake before the rift snapped shut. Hitler's final order was for the Karatekia to remake this rip and leave it wide open. They would inflict an unnatural Götterdämmerung on the victorious Allies at the expense of the entire planet. For three horrifying months in 1945, Delta Green fought the last battle of the European War against the Karatekia, Operation Lunacy. The accident was never recreated, and Action Götterdämmerung was obliterated in a series of covert actions that cost the lives of many agents and even more Karatekia members. In an unexpected catastrophe for the Karatekia, on June 15th of 1945, the fuel generator breaks free of its moorings and consumes Point 103. Only four project members survive, including Carl Ohlendorf, but their plane crashes on the Antarctic ice, and Ohlendorf is presumed dead. Along with this, former Karatekia researcher Dr. Gunter Frank purchases La Estancia, a massive rubber plantation in Brazil, using funds from artwork looted in Krakow and Paris. 7 months after the German surrender, the Paragon Foundation was established in Toronto, Canada as a front by Pisces to evaluate psychic phenomena and gifted individuals in the Western Hemisphere. Pisces also uses the foundation to conduct secret investigations of unnatural activities in the region. The following years would be busy for Pisces, as after visiting the island of Erta in the St. Kilda Archipelago west of Scotland, David Cornwall designates the site as the home for Pisces' new laboratory and containment facility. By the end of the year, the first underground facilities had been constructed, and work began on the medieval metaphysics laboratory, which later became known as Magnolia. Pisces also carries out several archaeological intelligence, or ARC-INT, operations around the globe, including a notable one in Borneo with military assistance provided by the 21st SAS Regiment. However, all would change on the 24th of June 1947, as thunderstorms apparently caused an unidentified flying object to crash near Roswell, New Mexico. In the following video of this series, we will pick up with the fallout of the Roswell crash and the creation of Majestic 12. As usual, please remember to like and subscribe to support the content being produced on this channel, and of course, any suggestions on improvements or future subjects are highly appreciated. Until then, good luck and good day.